Hi, in this video we're going to look at the box.xinabox.cc enclosure builder. Okay, so you got yourself a kit, like for example this XKR1, and you want to put it into a box similar to this 3D printed box I made here. So the right thing to do is to use our enclosure builder box.xinabox.cc. So I loaded it up, and if you are loading up, you will get a screen like this. So let me quickly go through how this thing here works. There are some parameters that have to be filled in, and it will then generate a box file. You can then generate the STL, and that STL you can either put into your own 3D printer or you can send it for printing outside. So we have two sections. We have the top section here, which is generic parameter, and then we have the cutaways, which cut away different holes in a box. So the first thing to do is to figure out what is the shape of your device you built. So in this case here, we built two in the X direction and three in the Y direction. So we go in here and put in three. Can either do it like that or type. And the first thing I do is say update. I can click in on instant update, and it will update every time I change something. So now we have this thing here. You can zoom a little bit out so you better can see it. And you can see there's another number of numbers here. And those number refers to these numbers here in cutaway. You can have more than one. So you can simply go in and say, for example, this one here, I want to change that to, you know, five. And you can have them in any order. They're just pre-filled in here, so you don't have to put them in. So now that you have done the first part here by setting up what is the amount of X-tips you want to put in, the next one is a wall millimeter. Now that wall millimeter is the thickness of the wall. So if I look here from the side, it's the thickness that I have here. And that thickness is a lid thickness. It's a thickness here. This lip here that goes into the box is the same, 2 millimeter. And the bottom wall, that's the back wall here, is also 2 millimeter. So that's a good standard. If you have, you want to do this thing here, maybe in aluminium, or you want to use this tool here to cut it out in, or you have a, let's say for example, the SLS printer you want to use, you might want to change the wall millimeter to a lower height. The space is the space that is allowed between the X-chip's wall here. So you can see here between this standoff, there is a millimeter here. If you have a very accurate printer, or you do it, for example, in aluminium, and you are absolutely sure that you will have the correct spacing, then you can set it to zero. Each X-chip is 31.8 times 31.8. millimeter, and there's allowed space here for 32 millimeter, which is a standard kind of like algorithm to make space, is putting in 0.1 millimeter around. But because this is printed with the FDM printer, we're not 100% sure how much it will be accurate. So we set it to 1 millimeter, and it will create this little space in between the blocks and the wall, allowing it to slip in easier. Then we have the enclosure height. So this 15 millimeter is the height of the enclosure, excluding the lids and the wall. So it's not the 2 millimeter on the bottom, and it's not the top here. So the total enclosure height right now is 15 plus 2 for the bottom and 2 for the top. So it's now in total 19 millimeter high. So if I want to have it 15 millimeter high, for some reason, I have to change it and update it like that. The last part is a standoff inside here. These are set as default 5 millimeter in height. And that may be a little bit high. So if you don't have anything specific underneath, so the thing, if you look at this from the side here, you can see that it's only the CW1 shield here that sticks under. So 5 millimeter is from the bottom of the PCB and to the top of the back wall. So this is the 5 millimeter here. So if you want to cut it fine, a good idea is to take an instrument like this thing here. So I turn it on and I can now go in and measure. And the easiest thing is to actually to measure the full height of the PCB. So you can see it says 4.6 millimeter. The PCB is 1.6 millimeter typically. So even though it says 1.5, it's sometimes 1.57, but the actual official thickness is 1.6. So you have to leave 3 millimeter for this thing here underneath. Okay, oops, I had some component in my way here. So here we have our 4.5.6. So I will say if this one here have to be right against the back wall, I would put in 3 millimeter, but I don't have to go all the way down there. So let's put it like 3.3 millimeter. So now I made the box a little bit thinner towards the total height of the box here. Now, then we have a text, and that text can be any text. You can write your company name or whatever you want to. And that text is being used in the cutaways to actually put in a text in your box. I have to say, logo and text is not as good on FDM printing. It's brilliant for all kind of other things, but it tends to be a little bit more difficult to print because it will be on the surface of the lid and on the back of the box, and they are printed with the bottom down, which means that's a little bit of overhang. The rest of the stuff prints beautifully, but text and logo is not the greatest to put in. And then in this make here, you can say you want to have made the box, the lid, or 3D print ready. The difference between both and 3D printer is that the lid here is turned around to the back. So 3D print ready is the best way of printing it if you can print both at the same time. And box and lid is just these two in different components. So when you generate the STL file, you can do that separately. So I'm coming back to that. And then you can say if you want to have rounded corners. So if you say yes to rounded corners here and say update, it takes a little longer time for it to calculate. So I typically do it when I'm finished. And it allows to have rounded corners instead of these very sharp corners in the box. So the whole box will be rounded, as you can see here. So both the lid will be rounded and the box will be rounded. So if you choose that, then do it as a last thing in order to speed up your process here. So let's go back to no, and I'm gonna change this thing here back to 2 just so it goes a little bit faster for updating the file here. So now we have this, then let's look at the cutaways. So there's many different cutaways, and the easy thing is actually just to try them one at a time. So if you have the display LED, so that's the ODO1, you can, for example, decide you want to have a display in that corner here. So if I say display on number 2 and say update, it will then create a hole for the display. One of the things that's important with this thing here is it will create a lip around here to kind of like give it a better feeling of a complete selection. So this height here is calculating based on what we know what the height of the ODO1 is. So there's a little bit of slack, but otherwise it goes all the way down to the glass. So it will give it a better look. On one here, let's take the next one. So that's a display reverter. So this is for the built-in display, we have a reverter. And that's actually only useful if you build a very big circuit which is like 4 X-tips the one way and 3 X-tips the other way. You can play with that. We use it specifically for our reverted display and adapter. Then we have a light sensor. So if I go into number 4 here and put in sensor light. Then we will have a little hole that's like approximately a 10 by 10 millimeter in size. So this works for most of our light sensors. So the infrared temperature sensor, it works for the SLO6 light sensor and so on. But if you have a SLO1, which have two sensors that sit a little bit apart, then go for the one that's called sensor full. That's also useful, for example, for the CapTouch interface. So this gives you as much access to the X-tips as possible. And then we have, for example, this sensor grill, which is, you know, meant for a gas sensor. So it gives a little kind of like grill interface. It's the same size as the other one that was called sensor light, but it just have like these bars here to give it a look as a protection for the gas sensor. We have a couple of LEDs. So if we take, for example, LED here, and now we have to go back and choose it in one of these four because we don't have a number five. So let me just go up here and say LED and say update. And it will create a LED. So for example, if you look here at the CW1, you have an LED in the middle, or the IPO1 also have an IP and an LED in the middle. So these two, this is for this LED. On the same one as number one here, so let me just change that to one to demonstrate that. I can also put a power LED in. So for example, the IPO1 here have a power LED here in the corner, and some of the components, the power components, they will have an LED down in the corner there. So it's a small little hole, just enough that the light can come through. We have AIO4, which is like a hole, especially for the AIO4, which is like our expander module. And then we have a text. So the text you wrote up here, like company, if you want to have that here underneath the grill here, number three, we'll put in three here and say update. And it then writes the text here, company. Can't change font or size or anything like that. So it's just to maybe give you an opportunity to write your own stuff on the box. Then we have stuff that is related to the box itself. So the power USBs, and that this power and output is holes in the side of the box. So just to make it a little bit easier, I'm gonna go in and say box only. So now we're just looking at the box. So if I tilt it like this thing here and say number one is up there and I want to have a power USB, and let's just in number two have a power micro USB so you can see the difference. So the difference here is that you have a, sorry, not number two, obviously number three. So if you put in number two, it'll cut away, but there's nothing to cut away. So just make sure you choose the right thing. And you will have the micro USB for the power unit that uses micro USB. And this is for the unit that using the, like the IPO1 here that uses normal USB-A. You can also put them on the same one. So I can still say, with a micro USB here, put it into the same hole, and that way I can make a box that can accept both the one connect and a one type and another type if I like that. So you can see here that I have now two cutaways here. Then we have a power switch, which is for the PB04. Okay, so now the power switch is sitting on the top here. So the way that this is, the box is designed, is it's designed for the various chips to be in the way you read them. You can, of course, build chips where you actually click them in to, you know, different sides here. So if you have an opportunity to build it, so for example, this one here, I could put in sideways. Then, yes, the LED for this thing here will work, but some of the other stuff will not rotate because it simply doesn't know the rotation. So the PB04 will typically sit here between 2 and 4. So when you refer to it, you refer it to from the from the left to the right or from the bottom to the top. So in the case here where we say we want to put in a power switch, we have to put that in to number 2, and then we say update, and it will then put the power switch in the middle, as you can see here, because it's actually X-chip that takes up the whole width of the box here, and the power switch sits right in the middle there. Then we have output. So now we have a couple of different. So we have a one that's called output 2. So we put that into number 2 here, and then in number 4 here, we put in number 3 to show the difference and say update. Then you will notice that it's just a matter of how width, what the widths are of those. So to give you an example, I have the OCO3 here, which is have a 2 output. And you can see it cut it up from the top, and that's just simply because the box is not tall enough. So if I go in and make the box taller, then it will make the box looking all right again. So the 2 is for something that have a 2 width output, and the 3 is for some of the X-chip that have like 3 terminals. And then we also have one that's called wide, which is for more or less unlimited access. So for example, the OCO5 here, if you want to put that in a box and have all the cables for the servers to go out, you will use that. And we have a couple of other X-chips that are using the full width. Then we have radio. So let's put a radio in here. So that's simply just a round hole for the antenna. So that will work if you, for example, have a radio similar to this ILO3 here. So you can see here is the SMA antenna. So this is actually for the SMA hole that goes out. And you can see that if we look at it, it goes a little bit below the PCB here. So because of that, you can also see the hole is actually, so it goes a little bit below, so it actually matches how this is screwed in. Then we have wall mount, and that we're putting up against the back of the box here. So if you want to, for example, have a couple of holes in the back so you can put screws in, then you simply just go in and say wall mount, and you put it in for each of the positions when you use it. You might also want to have one down at the bottom here so it doesn't kind of like lean out. Then there's a back logo. Now it doesn't matter what position you put in here, so I can put 7 in and say update. And what it does is it creates a logo on the back. So if I tilt it around, you can see here there's the X in a box logo that sits on the back. And we've done it here on a 3D print here, and it's all right, but it could certainly be better. It's much better on SLS printing, you know, resin style printing, than it is on FDM printing. Then we have an X in a box icon and an X in a box logo. So if I put X in a box icon here, number 1, and X in a box logo on number 2, and then I go up and show the lid, because that is gonna be on a lid. You will notice here that we have, and my logo came out as, so let's just make it 2 here. And there we have the logo, and we have the X in a box icon. On the box here we printed, we have the logo here printed on the front. So that concludes all the different kind of like cutouts. As we progress, we're gonna put in more cutouts, but that is how it works for now. Now, the most difficult thing to put together is not these cutouts. That's simply just a matter of choosing the different ones, see how it looks, and then, you know, rotate the device a little bit and see, okay, that seems to be fair. So the thing that's maybe the most difficult to put in is actually the enclosure height. How high should it exactly be? So if I put this back to 5, and I have, actually, let's do it this way here. Let's just start from scratch again. So we reload that, and we go in and say 3, and up. And then in number 1, we're going to put in our power USB because we know that's the one we want to do. And we're going to look at the box only and say update. So here we have it, the box. And here we have the opening. So on the screen here, I have the same opening. So you can see this is actually the same size box as I have here. There's an opening here for the USB 2. But you can see it's not as high up here as on my drawing here. So how high should it be? That's the thing. So the best way is actually, the easiest way you can do it is if you don't have an instrument like this in here, it's kind of like play around with the numbers on the screen. So it looks like that on the screen here, that this is a little bit too high. So why don't we cut away, let's say 3 millimeter, and see how that looks like. And of course, every time you do that, it's gonna take a little time because it have to calculate the box again. So apparently I went a little bit too drastic. So I wanted to do that instead. And you can see this is actually the standoff that's showing there. So you can do like a flat set that way. Okay, we cut a little bit down. Let's cut them down to 10. And then you can see now I missed stuff here. So where is that exactly? Let's put 10.5 and see if that is enough. Okay, that is enough. So let's just give it 10.6. And at 10.6, you'll notice that there's now a bar here. So that hole from the bottom to the top, it makes the wall 10.6, and remember the 10.5, okay? Now, because the lid have to fit in on the other side, there is a 2 millimeter lip here, this lip here, that have to go into the box, okay? So if you don't make it high enough, this thing here, this lip here, will be blocked by the USB connector. So we know that's 2 millimeter, so we actually have to make 2 millimeter higher than 10.5. That means that if you make it 12.5 with a standoff of 5, we have the ideal height for the box. So that is that's a way of actually, you know, go in and figure out how you have to have it. We use this instrument here to actually figure out how much it takes up of space below, like we did here, so we could reduce the standoff. So if that was 4.5 millimeter, knowing that this is, you know, 3 millimeter in total, we can reduce the standoff from 5 to 3, and that way, you know, lower the box in total. So if I go in here and say 3, and just to demonstrate it, I first say update, so we can just see that the hole then moves down like that. And then we want to go in and reduce it to 10.5 and say update. And we have ourselves slightly over a centimeter thick box that is perfect for this circuit here. So this is the smallest of the box here. This one here was done with 5 millimeter. And because the plastic, because it's FDM printed, we also wanted to give it a little bit of leadway in the Z axis. So we have a millimeter here and we added a millimeter to the side. So we had 5 millimeter here and we had a 12.5. And we change that to add 0.5 millimeter on top. So, 13. So that was actually the height of that. And of course, if I measure the height of that box like that, then you will get a box that is, you know, 4 millimeter higher. So you can see here, 17 millimeter is the whole box. So, the 13 plus 2 for the bottom layer and 2 for the lid gives the 17. Okay, so when it was 10.5 before, it is actually 15.5 millimeter in total. So I have a box here already made. So you can see in this case here, this is actually the box that's printed here. And what I've done is that I said it's 3D print ready here. So this is actually how it looks like. So there's 2x3. I put in all the different windows. This side here is still like 1 millimeter here. And I put 0.5 millimeter on the top. So it went to 13, making in total a 17 millimeter thick box. And I have all the different kind of layout here. So when I want to print this thing here, I can go in and say generate STL. And it takes a little while and you say download STL and you have a file that's called, in my case, output STL. It will rename it differently depending what browser you use. But I will just take this and say box lid STL. So this is if you have a printing facility that will allow you both objects to be printed at the same time. But many outsourcing software, they want to have each component in a separate file. So if you do that, you say box, you update. And there you have the box, you generate the STL, download the STL, and you go in, and now we call this box. And of course, similarly, you go in and say lids, and you say update, and you generate the STL, you download the STL, and we go in and we rename that to lid. So there we have the one is both 3D print ready and the other is separate. So a number of different services, for example, here's threadstock.com, where they have like a file for each. So this is the box STL file. So in this case here, I can kind of like move it a little bit around. And that is when I uploaded these two files. So here they kind of like suggest that I can buy it from different places here close to me for somewhere between $8 and $28 printed in PLA. I can go to this other website here where they suggested here that can only take one file. So therefore I use the combined file that can show both the lid and a box here. They want 26.13. And some of these are community driven. Some have their own store. There's some using professional printers. So this is printerthink.com. Here's another one here that's called facfox.com. And they only need $6 to print this thing here. And you can see here, they also take one file that have both the box and the lids in one go. So $6 for the entire box is not too bad. And then we have like 3D Hubs. And 3D Hubs here, they have like a tool where you can also view your box. So here I have it upside down. And they used to be community driven. Now they changed their philosophy to actually use commercial printers. So the price is going a bit up and it's going to be a little bit further away to get your stuff printed. So here they have, they insist on having a file separate. So the lid is separate, the box is separate. And you can see here that, you know, the lid will cost you $28 to print and $45. So $72 in 6 business days. So it varies a lot where it is. Here's another guy called Make X, Y, and Z. And they also have a tool here where you can, you know, look at your device, your boxes. And it's always nice to be able to look at it to see if your print facility have the same idea about your files as you have. So with that, I want to just end up and say, good luck with your printing. And here is a little box with the XK1 kit installed. Thank you very much.